Hi everyone, thanks very much for joining us. It's lovely seeing people from all across the world actually, so welcome. I'm Dr. Mike Thomas. I'm a lecturer in bio nanotechnology and biochemical engineering. So I've been teaching in the Department of Biochemical Engineering now for just under 3 years. I have a joint appointment between the London Centre for Nanotechnology, which is part of a UCL slash sort of London set of institutes that focus on nanotechnology and then biochemical engineering. So what I want to do is tell you a little bit about some of the things that I'm involved in teaching through the lens of rapid tests, which I think is, as Kim touched on just now, obviously it's something that's relevant to everyone, and everyone actually probably is a little bit familiar with them. I'm sorry to say the need for using them. So that should give you a nice gateway into what I'm talking about. But I'm actually going to talk about some of the underlying science and the underlying principles of how these things operate, and some of the research that I've done either prior to starting at UCL or within UCL on the development of ways to make better rapid tests. So it's always good to start off with an intro slide just to say a bit more about who we are. So I run the Thomas Lab. I'll touch on the specifics of who we are on the next slide, but just acknowledging the fact that some of the things that I'll talk about will be published research studies that are funded through various different funding agencies and sources of financial support. So it's always nice to just touch on these down at the bottom. So that's what that's referring to. Many of the projects are part of something called the iSense Interdisciplinary Research Consortium Collaboration. And that has underpinned a lot of the research that we've done. And so just good to include reference to that there. Okay, so who are we? Who is the Thomas Lab? Well, the Thomas Lab is just a name, but essentially we are the researchers in the Thomas Lab. So we've got PhD students, we've got undergraduate students, final year project students. So in this case, Sophia, who's one of our current final year, third year students, who's doing a project in our lab developing lateral flow diagnostic assays. And what are we trying to do? Well, our whole aim is to take something a bit like this, an expensive, quite complex piece of technology that can perform biological assays. So you might go into hospital, you'll give a sample of blood, for example, or a swab, a nasal swab, something like that. And usually it's getting analyzed by something like this in a hospital setting. But as we've seen recently, there's quite a big need for diagnostics that potentially work at the point of care, the point of need, perhaps at home, perhaps for self-testing. And there's a disparity here between what we require from these technologies. And so a lot of what my group does, a lot of what many groups do across the world, is understanding these, developing these, and making these work more effectively, particularly if we're looking at measuring very, very low quantities of a certain biomarker. I'll continually give the example of something like, say we've got SARS-CoV-2, we're looking to detect the viral capsid protein of that. So we're looking for a bit of virus in a patient sample. So we're looking to measure less and less than that. And that's ideally telling us earlier and earlier into infection, whether someone is infected or not. So what is the nano-bio interface or the bio-nano interface? What we generally mean about this is when we have a nanomaterial, it could be a particle, it could be a rough surface, it could be all sorts of different things, but it has dimensions that are in the nanoscale. So usually tens, hundreds, ones of nanometers, that's the nanoscale. And then this interface with the bio side of things, this refers to how proteins, biological molecules, these sort of things interact with the surface of those materials. So typically you'll find that if you interface a nanomaterial with a biological system like us, or perhaps a sample that you've taken from someone like a draw of blood, immediately lots of proteins, lots of things will stick at the surface of that particle. And so what we're interested in is how do we tailor that interface and make sure that it's presenting the things that we want it to present, and ensure that those are done in such a way that it's useful for making rapid tests more sensitive. So that's kind of the aim of what we're trying to do. As Kim said at the start, if some of this feels like it's entirely over your head, don't worry about it. The aim here is to kind of cover quite a lot of different things with a few research article examples as well. So some of the concepts will be quite complicated, but just absorb what you can. I'm hoping that you'll take away the fact that actually what biochemical engineering does underpins almost everything that I'm talking about in many, many different ways. And so it's highlighting the value of studying in biochemical engineering and what we can kind of take away from that. But as Kim said, if you do come and study with us, you will make heads or tails of this very easily. You'll understand this very easily. So don't worry if some of it feels a bit too advanced for now. So I'll start off just with an example of what sort of nanoparticle I'm talking about. So you may be aware that rapid tests, these lateral flow tests, work based off having nanoparticles in them that have a color, those stick at a test line. But the nanoparticle itself is quite a complicated thing and quite a heavily engineered thing. And so in a very simple sense, we can think of it as something like this. We've got a particle that has some properties. It may be that it's absorbing a lot of light. So it's like quite a strongly colored thing. It may be that it's fluorescent. It may be that it's catalyzing chemical reactions. It could be doing all sorts of things. And it has something on the surface that allows us to stick to a protein of interest that we're trying to measure. So in this system, we've drawn this very optimistically as antibodies all pointing in the same direction off the surface. The schematic looks very nice. Everything looks all very symmetrical. Great. In reality, of course, proteins don't look like this. Proteins are dynamic. They're doing all sorts of things. And this is the kind of thing that we're interested in putting on the surface of a particle, something like an immunoglobulin, an IgG. And what we have here is we have an Fc region. This is something which is host specific, depending on what this IgG has been raised in or modified to be expressed in. And then we've got these sort of Fab regions. And these are the sort of the business end of what we're interested in from a biosensing perspective. And they're the things that are binding to proteins specifically. And so in this case, let's say we come back to our SARS-CoV-2 nuclear capsid protein. We have antibodies that will bind specifically to that protein. And so we have now a way to interact our particle specifically with the protein that comes from the virus. And as you can imagine, how well this operates is pretty critical on whether you're actually measuring the interaction with this protein effectively or not. But before we kind of go any deeper into that, let's just take a little step back and talk a bit more about some of the basics. So what am I talking about here? Analytical science. Analytical science is an essential component of biochemical engineering. You can't manufacture things if you have no ability to measure things. So what do we kind of mean more generally by analytical science? Well, it's essentially separation, identification, and quantification. So we want to potentially separate something from something else. So it may be, if I give the example again of a viral protein in blood, let's say this time, blood has got a lot of stuff in it. So if we want to measure that, we might want to separate certain things out. We might want to separate the red blood cells out, for example. Identification, we want to make sure we're measuring the right thing, so the viral protein. And then quantification, we want to be able to say how much of it is there. So this is generally the three parts of what we're trying to do when we're thinking about analytical science. And what kind of thing will we end up with? So you might be familiar with your lateral flow test. You measure a sample, perhaps a red line appears. In my case, or in our case, when we're thinking about that, what we're actually thinking about is how red is that line? How much signal do we have at that test line? And typically a lateral flow test is very qualitative. And what that means is we're just looking for, is there a signal there at all? We're less concerned about whether there's a lot or a little. But actually, when we're developing diagnostics, we're very interested in this response because it tells us a lot of information. And so you might end up with something like this. And what we might have done here is maybe changed the amount of this particular protein that we've put in some buffer. So here, maybe we've got 100 picogram per mil, 1,000 picogram per mil, different concentrations. And we're just looking at how dark this test line looks as a function of these different concentrations. But what you tend to see at least if we're looking at a logarithmic scale of concentration, is something that looks like this sort of classical sigmoidal curve. And so here we're not seeing much change. This is sort of down at our limit of detection where we can't really see any signal at the test line. And then we have this sort of dynamic range where we're getting a lot of increase in signal. Then you get to the top end as well, where essentially it just looks dark red and it doesn't look any darker red, or we've used up our reagents in some way that means that we don't get any more signal generation. And generally we're interested in this kind of range here if we're looking to understand our assays a bit better, because that's where we're getting the biggest changes in signal with changes in concentration. This tells us a lot of information about the assay system that we're working with. An important point to note is error bars. So anything that we do in biochemical engineering, we're very interested in whether we can do it again and whether we can do it reproducibly. So statistics is a key part of what we're doing. So we're always repeating things, doing replicates, maybe that we're doing technical replicates, like the same thing on the same day, several times side by side. Maybe we're doing like larger scale biological replicates. So we kind of start from scratch. We do the whole thing again and we see, does it behave in the same way? But we're always generating error bars, and those error bars are very useful for us to know how confident we are in drawing some kind of conclusion. The way the error works is often actually very complicated. And I'm not going to get into all of the details of this, but I always like this plot because it gives you a nice way of looking at it. So I've given this a title, we can be very good at making a bad measurement. So, you know, if we have a bias in our measurement, we could be measuring the same measurement every single time really, really nicely. However, it's not true. It's an incorrect measurement. We could also be measuring it very poorly and it also be biased and incorrect as well. Or we could measure it such that it's all centered around the measurement that it should be, but there's a lot of variability when we're doing that. Or kind of often what we're aiming for is it gives you the right number and it also gives you the right number most of the time. And so depending on the spread of this data, this might tell us how many times we need to repeat this experiment before we can actually say, okay, I'm confident I know what this value should actually be. And that's where we get a parameter out by having a think about how many times we're having to repeat the experiment from our lateral flow development assays. And the parameter that we're interested in is the limit of detection. And so if we're just interested from your, you know, taking a lateral flow test at home perspective, where we just want to know, do we have an infection? We want to know what's the lowest concentration of that viral protein we can measure, where 95 times out of 100, we know we're going to get a result that you can see at the test line. And that's essentially something called a limit of detection for the particular assay we've developed, and a 95% confidence interval. And that's us saying that 95 times out of 100, we're going to get the correct result from this. And don't feel like you need to understand this, but all this is essentially saying is at our limit of detection, if we're generating a signal that's measurable and a certain number of times, if we've repeated this, you know, 1,000, 100,000 times, we might get a variety of different times that we successfully identify a measurement. And so at the limit of detection, perhaps our population is centered at this limit of detection, and we know that we get a certain fraction that are giving us signals as we go further away from this, but it's only above a certain point where we can, with 95% confidence interval, identify the difference from variation in a sample which doesn't contain any virus at all. And what we're essentially looking to do is to say, well, okay, what's the minimum number of experiments we can do to know what this population looks like for our blank with no virus and our sample with a very tiny quantity of virus, and then say, well, okay, can we tell these two apart from each other? And so we're using these sort of statistical methods and the way we think about designing our experiments to identify simple parameters that then give us something very useful. Because then if a public health service wants to buy in a new lateral flow test, they essentially want to know what this limit of detection is, and they want to know when patients test it, how often do they get the right result from this. The tricky thing with diagnostics and biosensing more generally is we're pulled in many different directions. And so to get that performance, to get that effective measurement, we're often saying, well, okay, ideally we'd use a large sample volume. So maybe we want to take a really big swab of a lot of material, nasopharyngeal swab, something like that, to have lots of protein in it. So we have more material to measure. And that's often something that helps us with performance and more sensitivity. The problem is it also leads to a longer experiment because it takes more time to process that material. So actually we often find we're doing a balancing act to get the best performance we can within a certain time frame for a certain sample volume. And there's lots of constraints acting on us. So there's a lot of optimization of parameters that need to be done there. And that's true generally in biochem-eng. So a lot of the things that we want to do, if we're trying to manufacture, for example, is to do a balancing act of various different things and think about cost, ease, these kind of things. So again, it's the same thing when we're developing a diagnostic, but we're doing it in a slightly different application. So natural flow assays are actually incredibly good. I know we've seen sort of various press on natural flow assays, but actually to have something that operates as an analytical device in the space of tens of minutes and has the sensitivity that natural flow assays do have is actually amazing. So by comparison, if we wanted to do something called an ELISA, so an enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, which is kind of a classic way in the laboratory of measuring the concentration of proteins, we might need to set aside half a day to do that experiment. And it may not be much more sensitive than a lateral flow test operates in 10 minutes. And a lateral flow test is significantly cheaper and requires less material. So actually, these things are really, really good. But for certain diseases, for certain infections that we're interested in monitoring, the amount of material that we're trying to measure is tiny. So sometimes we ask too much of it. So from my perspective, I'm interested in how do we make sure these lateral flow devices can operate well enough for that. So how does a lateral flow assay operate? Well, some of you might be familiar with this, but essentially you've got your protein of interest in a sample, whatever that may be. You drop it onto a collection port on the device. It mixes with particles. Now, these are the same particles I talked about earlier, and they have antibodies on the surface. Those antibodies and particles will interact with the analyte. Maybe they'll bind immediately, and you'll have these little analytes decorated on the particle. Maybe the analytes will stick at the test line as things are migrating up, and the particles may stick to them there. There's all sorts of different things that could be happening. But what we're looking to achieve is particles bound with one antibody to an analyte, and then that analyte also acting to sandwich to another antibody that's stuck on our piece of paper. And these devices are all driven by capillary action and liquid wicking through porous paper. So cheap materials, simple mechanisms of operation, generally speaking. But in reality, the components in here, there's a lot of them and there's a lot of complex things going on. But what we get at the end of the day is a color buildup at the test line. So when we measure this, we're doing something simple like taking a photo of the test. And when we take a photo of the test, we're looking at the difference in color between a test line and the local region around it. And that's what's giving us this signal value that you saw in some of the plots earlier and you'll see again in a moment. What are the kind of particles that we're using? Well, traditionally, it's something like a gold nanoparticle. And the reason we're interested in gold particles is firstly because they're strongly colored. And gold particles are an amazing thing. You can produce them relatively easily. They absorb light very strongly and you can tailor the color to a degree at least, depending on the size or the shape. But they also do something interesting where when they aggregate, that is to say when particles come together, the color changes as well, as does the color when you bind proteins onto the surface. So when we make these, it's a bare metal surface with a few very small molecules on the surface, really tiny molecules. When we stick proteins on, we decorate the surface with a few nanometers of protein. And that changes the way that the particle generates color, which is counterintuitive, but I'll explain that in a second. That's really useful for us for characterizing when we put proteins on the surface, because we know just based on their color, whether we're doing that correctly. And the particles themselves, typically for lateral flow tests might be 40 nanometers in size. This is some particles that are about 20 nanometers in size. But you can see here, this is transmission electron microscopy. We're essentially looking at different atomic facets and layers in these little nanoparticles. And these particles then absorb light incredibly strongly through a mechanism called a surface plasmon. Again, don't really worry about what this is. I'm just telling you because I think this is fascinating. But when you have a particle of metal, some of you may be aware of conduction electrons. So metals conduct electricity. That means that electrons can move through metals. When you shine light on these nanoparticles, light has an electric field that oscillates. And so if you have light of a certain wavelength interacting with your little nanoparticle, the electric field in the light is actually causing the electrons to move in the particle. And that's a transfer of energy. And that leads to a change in the color of the light that's interacted with the particle. And while you don't need to know the details of this, what it means is these particles are incredibly good at absorbing light that hits them. And so what you get is, say, a 20 nanometer gold particle has an extinction coefficient. This is essentially how much light is absorbed by these particles for a certain thickness of sample, given its concentration. And it's about 1,000 times higher than some of the best absorbing organic dyes, so chemical compounds that you might find as a pigment in your shirt or something like that. So these are great at absorbing light. And for our diagnostic assay, that's great, because we want to have a scenario where we have one of these little star-shaped proteins from the virus anchoring one particle to our test line. And so if our particle absorbs as much light as possible, that should help our sensitivity. So one thing that's quite important to have a think about is mass transport in a lateral flow assay. So we've got particles mixing with analytes in samples and liquids of various viscosities going through porous membranes. There's a lot of movement and motion of these systems. Let's see if the, okay. So what I'm showing you there is two particle sizes. So our particle, a nanoparticle here, may be 100 nanometers in size. Our target protein may be 2.5 nanometers in size, 5 nanometers in size. So there's a big difference in the dimensions of these things. And what that means is our little protein is much more diffusive. It's better able to move around and diffuse. And what's happening there is, you know, you've got thermal energy in the liquid, so energy in everything, it's a liquid. Collisions are happening between water molecules and proteins, or water molecules and particles. And that thermal energy that the system has is causing the protein or the particle to move around. And the smaller proteins are able to move and cover more ground more quickly. They can rotate faster, they can do all sorts of things faster. And that's quite important because it means that the way that the sample, those proteins in the sample and our particles interact, is quite complicated depending on the sizes and the way it mixes. So a good example of this is concentration. So in our sort of suspension of sample, say we've dropped our sample onto that conjugate pad and it's mixed with those particles. If our analyte is really low in concentration, say at our limit of detection, we may only have a vanishingly small number of these little analytes. And so the time taken for those to diffuse to a big particle might be quite sizable. And it might mean that any one time, there's very few collisions between analytes and particles to have a binding event. So for our particle to measure and interact with that analyte. But if you increase the concentration of particles, you then reduce that time requirement. So this analyte here only needs to travel a short distance to then collide with a particle. And maybe it needs to do that a few times before a successful collision where it's actually detected by that IgG on the particle. But you can see here how the mass transport, the way things need to interact with each other, is very dependent on a parameter such as the concentration of the particles. And it's not only dependent on something like the concentration, and what that's essentially doing is it's determining the frequency of the collisions between the protein and the particle. It's also dependent on how many antibodies are on the surface, and that determines how likely a collision is to be successful. So for this analyte to actually interact with the particle in the right way to hit that antibody in the right way to stick to it. And then it's dependent also on how long it stays occupied on the particle. Does it bind, stay around for a few milliseconds and then come off? Does it stay on for 10 hours and come off? That tells us then what fraction of our analyte might be bound to a particle at any one time. So when we think about this as kind of engineers, biochemical engineers, we, along with others around the world, apply mass transport models to these kind of things. And so we can think about, okay, we've got a series of different kinetic interactions between different components. And we can think about, if we model all of those at the same time and we think about liquid flowing across this strip, what's the result? What's the proportion of analyte that binds a particle to a test line? What's the proportion of analyte that's stuck to a particle that's missed the test line and just disappeared off? And we can start to develop models to understand these things better. This is a very powerful thing to be able to do. And it allows us conceptually to start to understand systems without experimentally having to do it to begin. And that's useful from a financial perspective. It's useful from an industrial perspective. If we can understand and model our systems and understand what are critical components, critical parameters to optimize it, we can reduce costs as well and then experimentally evaluate those later. And that feeds into a whole mindset of biochemical engineering, where we want to develop models, computational simulation models of systems that we're developing as well, to understand them and to optimize them. So as I said before, lateral flow tests are actually pretty good. Here's some data produced by one of my students, and we're looking at one of these dose response curves. And what we've got right here is an assay that took about 10 minutes to give you a limit of detection somewhere around tens of nanogram per mil. A nanogram per mil is a really low concentration of something. That's a vanishingly small concentration of a protein. Yet you can do this simply in the lab, create something on nitrocellulose, this sort of paper membrane we're spotting antibodies on, we're making particles, functionalizing them, and create a very sensitive test that operates very quickly. And that's by virtue of the way that we understand and create a diagnostic device that works as well as it can, given our understanding of mass transport limitations and reaction kinetics in these assays. So there are many ways to boost the sensitivity. And here's just one example. So I've already touched on the importance of surface coverage of antibodies and why we think of that in terms of how many collisions we get and whether it's in the right position. But here's an example of a model. Again, this was generated by one of our fourth year undergraduate project students last year, Davika, building on work published in the literature. And what we can see here is just a simple conclusion, which is the associative rate of our antibody, that is to say, the rate at which the antibody is able to bind and interact with an analyte, and then subsequent to that, it may dissociate, but we're interested in the association, so how quickly it can stick to it. If we change this a lot, and our traditional antibodies, monoclonal antibodies that we might be interested in, maybe have these associative rates around 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5, that's a good antibody. But you can see here, if we span a few orders of magnitude in association rate, it makes a huge difference in how well our particle is able to bind the analyte and then bind to the test line in our lateral flow device, this receptor particle analyte complex, which is what's giving us our signal. And here, that's a drastic difference in performance. So you can see how, if we have antibodies that work well, and if we can decorate them on particles effectively, that makes a big difference in how sensitive our assay is going to be. So I've alluded to this a little bit, but mass transport underpins much of what we do in biochemical engineering. It helps us understand the systems that we're working with and optimize them and design experiments that are more likely to be successful off the back of it. It's useful in bioreactors, thinking about diffusion, reaction, mixing, but also separation. And a lateral flow assay is a separation. The rapid test we're talking about now is a separation technique, but that applies in different ways. Ion exchange chromatography, affinity chromatography, when we're purifying monoclonal antibodies, different protein products. So these are all interlinked with each other. A key one is do we make something well? So if we're manufacturing a monoclonal antibody, for example, is it correctly folded? Is it pure? Is it correctly glycosylated? Does it bind as well as it can? these are all parameters that we're looking to ensure that we can control and manufacture effectively. And that makes a big difference in the quality of the product. And we have various sort of critical quality attributes that we're always trying to ensure are being met when we're manufacturing. And if I want to develop a diagnostic assay, or someone wants to create the next SARS-CoV-2 lateral flow assay, they rely on those antibodies being made well and being made reproducibly. And that's this critical link between biochemical engineering and biosensing development. So how can we reduce this limit of detection even further? So a key one, unsurprisingly, is to address this nano-bio interface. So can we actually make something like this where the antibodies are presented effectively? We can load lots of them on there. What can we do? So this I find is a useful visual rather than worrying about the equation. But what we're essentially doing here is saying, well, okay, if we've got an antibody and we're talking about this associative rate that we showed in the mass transport models a few slides ago, and we want to say, okay, the higher that is, the better. We get more of this RPA complex, the particles at the test line bound through our antigen of interest. Then if we increase the number of antibodies on the particle, we increase this likelihood of a successful collision between the analyte and a particle at a point where there's an antibody binding site, this fab of the antibody on the surface. And what this equation is doing is essentially saying to us, well, okay, if we have more and more and more, what's the statistical likelihood of having a successful collision when there is a protein coming towards the particle? And what we see here is by increasing the number of antibodies, bear in mind this is a logarithmic scale, the effective associative rate of the particle rather than just the antibody scales hugely with increasing the number of antibodies on the surface. Now, this is a simple model. So often when we're thinking about modeling systems, we're making simplifications. We're not treating it in its entirety. But in this case, what we're saying is, okay, we assume that the number of binding sites we can increase, but we don't consider steric hindrance. And what that means is if you're trying to jam loads of things all on the surface, you'll reach a point eventually where they're hitting each other and they're blocking each other. So this region here is very much where we're expecting that steric hindrance to happen. But down here, this is where it's interesting for us, where if we actually get more and more and more antibodies on the surface, that particle is going to do a better job of binding an analyte and holding onto it. And so what do the antibodies actually look like on the surface? And this shows where there's opportunity for us. So firstly, that the traditional way of putting antibodies on gold is you mix them together. So we have a bare gold surface that's capped with this small compound called citrate. And then we interact our antibodies to it in a clean buffer, and those proteins will stick, electrostatically interact with the surface. So we've got some charge interactions, perhaps some hydrophobic interactions with onto the metal surface. And we end up with something that's quite uncontrolled. And so we have various different techniques we can use to try and understand what we're actually making here. So we talked about this plasmon resonance, this localized surface plasmon resonance. This is telling us a bit about whether we've got antibodies on the surface. So here's a sort of an example plot we might have. If we have a gold particle, which is in this case, the dashed black line here. And then this is this plasmon resonance. This is the wavelength of light that just happens to make those electrons oscillate really effectively in the particle. And when we stick antibodies on the surface, those antibodies interact with that electric field as it's oscillating in the particle, and they change the way that it operates when it's being excited. And what it does is it changes the energy level of the light that's interacting predominantly with the particle. And so we just see a little bit of a change here, just a few nanometers in the wavelength of light that's being absorbed. But that's enough for us to monitor when we've got saturation of the surface. And so this is just different amounts of antibody per particle. And we can see that we're shifting this here. So techniques like UV-Vis are powerful for us. They also tell us if it's aggregated. So if these were aggregated, we'd start to see a broad shoulder here in this spectrum. And that would tell us immediately that the system's unstable and it's starting to aggregate. But we have other techniques like DLS. This is dynamic light scattering. And what this is doing is we're shining a laser at our particles and we're looking for how does the light scatter back at us. And what are the features of that light that tell us a bit about how fast the particles are moving in solution? And what we get out of it is the average sizes of these different particles in solution. So we can also see the same thing where if we put more protein on the surface, we start to shift the average size of our particle. And the particle diameter here is essentially telling us how big is this object as it's diffusing through solution. So that's a hydrodynamic diameter that it's giving us. And what we also see is this aggregation. So as we start to flocculate, bring these particles together, not intentionally, that might just be we're exploring how to make these particles and functionalize them. And some parameters we're using don't work well. We can see that by DLS. So DLS is telling us similar information. So it's telling us about when we've got protein stuck on the surface, how big is the particle getting? And this is giving us a hydrodynamic diameter or radius. And what that is a particle with proteins on the surface has a slip plane between water and the particle surface. And we're looking at just how big is that slightly hydrated particle as it's diffusing through our liquid. And we're firing a laser light, a laser beam onto the sample and looking at how it scatters off it to look at how that's diffusing in solution. And that's powerful to tell us about size changes and aggregation. Then we also have this technique TRPS, tunable resistive pulse sensing. And this technique does it in a slightly different way. So again, sometimes we use complementary techniques that check things in different ways to make sure they're all working. This technique has a pore, a small pore, and then we're looking at how the particles diffuse through that pore. And when they do that, we get a change in the potential and the current across that pore. And so we're essentially then measuring parameters that tell us about how quickly it goes through a pore for a given pressure behind it, and what the surface charge is of that particle and how it's sort of, how that determines the way it migrates through that pore. And so then we're measuring individual particles. So DLS is everything, how everything's scattering light. TRPS is each particle we measure. So then we start to count properties of each one. So we've got a huge number of techniques we can use to characterize these systems. And these are techniques that we also use for everything else that we do in biochemeng. So if we've made a formulation of an antibody that we want to monitor, see whether it's stable, precipitating, these are all the techniques that we would use as well. UV-Vis to monitor scattering, absorption of light, DLS to look for dimerization, clustering, aggregate formation, TRPS, say we're developing a virus-like particle and we want to look at heterogeneity, differences amongst the material we've made, we can use TRPS. So again, the same techniques can inform all different areas of what we're doing. So in reality, I alluded to it in the past slide, but phys absorption is quite messy, and DLS is great for this because it tells us this subtle difference. So if they were all oriented on end, we might expect a certain hydrodynamic diameter or radius of the particle, but we never see that. We rarely see that. And it's only under certain conditions can we push this system and the way the proteins interact to orient correctly. But we can use these techniques to characterize this. So in this case, because we've got a mix of side on and end on, the effective hydrodynamic size is smaller than it would be if we had this theoretical oriented attachment. And what does this mean for our particles? Well, think about it in terms of the Fab binding sites. These are the business end that interacts with our analyte we want to measure. Anything that's bound like this, or bound like this, is obscuring these binding sites. So we have less binding sites than we would like to have on the particle. Less binding sites, as we know from some of our mass transport models, means the association rate of this particle to an analyte is less. So the likelihood of successful collisions is less. So we really want to improve this and make this better. And one of the approaches that I and others have used in the past is things like changing the way we interact the protein with the surface. So this is just a study where we looked at doing chemical attachment of proteins onto the surface of the particle. And just want to bring you to the difference here that we get between the two approaches. So phys-absorbed antibody, don't worry about the naming, but phys-absorbed antibody, so chaotic random ordering, gives us this response function. Chemical attachment with specially designed chemistries to orient it in a certain way brings this limit of detection down significantly. So again, it's just one of those examples where if we have good control over the way that we present proteins on the surface of particles, it can make big differences in the effective kinetics, which we now understand because we model and we understand the systems that we're developing. So another approach to improve the performance is this signal concept. So how do we make these particles bright? So approaches to do this, I'll just cover this quite briefly to make sure we've got enough time at the end for questions, but making a brighter particle, so we can use a catalyst. So this is an example where we used a particle, rather than the gold particle, it's a platinum particle. And that particle can turn a colorless chemical reagent into a black chemical reagent. And as it's doing so, the black chemical reagent sticks onto paper. And so wherever we've got particles generating signal, we're then sticking this black product onto the paper locally. And that's an amplification technique. So we say, well, okay, maybe we don't have so many of these stuck, but when we do have them stuck, they can make more signal themselves. And so these kind of particles, there's a lot of engineering that goes into this. How do we construct them, scale them up? How do we engineer them such that they have the highest surface area for catalysis? So these are very rough particles. And what you get out of it is an enhancement factor. So this amplification. So this is the kind of similar to the response curves you've seen earlier, where you've just got the color of the particle. And then this is after we've done the chemical reaction to create this black product that increases and amplifies the signal. And you can see here, we had about a factor of 100 increase in the limit of detection or reduction in the limit of detection. So now we're talking about picogram per mil as opposed to nanogram per mil that we were talking about for the previous data set. And this makes a big difference in the case, this example of HIV infection diagnosis. We're measuring again the viral protein, but we can measure this at much lower concentrations and monitor and detect the presence of infection earlier with a lateral flow like this. We can also do this with size, so we can make the particles bigger. And so this is a lovely study that came out recently, which is a collaboration between us and the McKendree group, particularly Ben Miller. And this was essentially saying that if we increase the size of our particles, and so in this case, we've got little gold particles decorated onto a much bigger bead. The extinction coefficient that we talked about, you know, how the 20 nanometer gold was 1,000 times more absorbing than a single dye molecule. Now we have 500 of these gold particles on one bead. So you can see we've now got a big signal per particle. Tricky thing is that we know about mass transport now, and a big particle is less diffusive. So actually you're playing off these different parameters, but what we can get is very sensitive detection of very low concentrations of a particular analyte by reducing or increasing the size of the particle. But that doesn't always work. And that's this subtlety of the mass transport. So ensuring that we understand the engineering of these systems and that we understand that the principles that drive their operation is absolutely essential to then developing new and improved devices and technologies. So that brings me to the end of what I wanted to cover. All of these approaches rely on the tools, characterization techniques, and technologies that are enabled or drive biochemical engineering. So here's a nice example of how a lot of the things that you might usually expect from biochem eng actually can feed and drive entirely different areas in terms of biosensor and diagnostic development, but it relies off this core of what biochemical engineering does. So thank you to my group, funders, different people involved in some of the projects that I've shown you, and thank you all for listening. So I think we're good for questions.
Yeah, absolutely. Please, we're really looking forward to your questions. Anything that you want to ask, anything you want to clarify, if you want to go back over any of the particular slides, please let us know in the Q&A box. One person has actually asked if they can mention these in college applications. I mean, I think that'd be a great idea. If you want to talk about this session or any of the sessions that you've attended in the context of a UCAS statement, I think it'd be a really good way to bring your interests and how they align with ours into that. I'm going to, but I also just want to mention that we've got, there's an open day coming up at UCL. So if you're interested in studying a degree with us, we've got virtual open days happening on the 25th and 27th of May. I'll put a link in that in the chat shortly. But if you go to UCL's open day page, you can register for that. If you're interested in coming and seeing us in person, we're actually doing an open day in person in UCL for the first time in 3 years, which is really exciting for us because we get to show you around our laboratories. And the thing that makes us unique in the UK is that we're the only department that teaches biochemical engineering specifically as a biochemical engineering department. Chemical engineering departments teach aspects of biochemical engineering, but they are fundamentally chemical engineering departments. So if you want to know more about the difference between chemical engineering, biochemical engineering, the kind of careers that you could have with a degree from biochemical engineering, come along and meet us either online or in person, which would be even better because then we can show you around and we can introduce you to the team, and you can see the campus, which is a great place to be in central London. What I'm going to do is, whilst I just get the link for the undergraduate open day, I'm just going to hand back to Mike quickly. I think one question which I've just got is, perhaps you could just mention the ref, because that's something that's coming up. Perhaps you could just briefly mention what the Research Excellence Framework is. I'm going to get that link, post it in the chat, and if there are no questions, we'll hope that actually that we answered everything you had about this subject. But there's still a few moments to pop a question in the Q&A box.
Sure, I'll do that. Hopefully everything was clear. REF is actually a very interesting thing. So it's the Research Excellence Framework is something that's emerged over the last kind of decade. And what it aims to do is ensure that we have maximum value for investment, particularly from public sources in research at universities. So what we do is every several years, we have a REF submission period. And what we do is we take example studies that we've done and that we've published, and we're looking for impact. And so historically, impact was maybe measured by, you know, how many or which journal you publish your paper in, something like that. But actually impact now is really about, has anything come out of what you've done? Has it been used by others? Has it led to any intellectual property? Has it led to spin-out companies? Like, how has it impacted the nation, the world? And that's a really interesting exercise. So one of the examples that I showed you earlier on the catalytic particles was an example REF study that we used, because that's actually spawned a huge amount of impact off the back of it. There's now a startup that's building off those technologies. It's secured many rounds of funding off the back of it because it's got so much potential. And that's really something that biochemical engineering does incredibly well across the board, is because it links so heavily with industry and the way that we ensure that what we're delivering is what industry is after. You know, we have accredited MSCs, for example. You know, the whole point here is that we're doing research and development that is inherently impactful, which makes it good for us when we're doing our REF case studies, because we have that ability to show what we've done and what we've researched and what we're developing is at the cutting edge, and it's delivering on things that are valuable for society more generally.
Brilliant, thank you. There's a question that's come up. I'll read this out if it's okay. In practice, how to select particles to minimise the occurrence of false negatives?
Okay, so interesting one. Minimising the occurrence of false negatives, we essentially want the best performance we can get from the particle. So we need to ensure the particle binds the analyte reliably, and we need to ensure that it binds it in the kind of low concentrations that we need to have a necessary clinical outcome. So it may be that for certain biomarkers we're trying to measure, if it's very low, it clinically is not important, but it may, for an infectious disease, anything measured is good. So if we want to reduce the generation of false negatives, we need to have better performing particles, and so that's what we're trying to achieve. An interesting one though is false positives. And so we talked about concentration of particles and increasing concentration of particles being better to get sensitivity. A downside of that is something called non-specific binding. And that's when our particles stick at a test line without an antigen present. That can lead to false positives. And actually that's a real problem. And so all we're doing often is trying to reduce false positives and ensure we've got effective binding of those particles in the first place. So decorating reagents on the surface effectively, ensuring we don't have any denaturation, any degradation of those proteins on the surface is critical to tackle both of those different issues. But it's a very good question.
Great, thank you. So I posted that chat. Mike, too, if you could do me just one favour and stop screen sharing just for a moment. Yep. I'm thinking in terms of how we're going to do a screen grab for the YouTube page at the end of this, because this and all the other sessions that we've done will be recorded and will be made available on YouTube and UCL Media. So it'll take us a couple of weeks to sort the transcription out for this, to make it accessible and send it out. But in the meantime, you can actually go on to, if you search on YouTube, UCL Engineering, you'll find last year's talks available as well. And John Hales did one on virus laser detection. So if you found this interesting, you might find, I mean, that one ties in well with this. Apart from that, I'm just going to say thank you very much for attending. Thank you for the questions. They're very interesting. And I really hope to see you in some of the other sessions we've got coming up. But finally, thank you very much, Mike. Really appreciate you taking the time to do this. And hope you have a great day. And we've got another message come through. Thank you very much. So very kind words. Thank you.
Absolute pleasure.
For the session. So thanks for that comment in the chat. Have a great day. And we really hope that we see you in UCL in person at some point in the future. Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.